workers is the best music teacher. Every day you can see her smile, and then you smile, and then you.
And I was the director for Beauty and the Beast. Disney's great for China because it's a little bit more familiar, the story is, and also there's a lot of spectacle. So even if the audience isn't understanding every word that's being said, there's enough visually that's really interesting. And we had good costume people, we had good set people, so we're like, if we're gonna do a big Disney show, now is the time to do it. As far as which script to do, Beauty and the Beast just had a really good script. It's still funny, like the movie, and it had really good characters. Like, it's not just like one main girl and one main boy. There's lots of fun characters that we could see our students doing and really excelling at. So that's why we chose Beauty and the Beast. I feel like a lot of my job was tech related, so there was a lot of tech stuff that was challenging, like figuring out how to transform the Beast into a prince. No big deal, but I had never worked with fog machines before, so it was me working with the special effects people, working with the costume people, working with actors to try to find something that worked. So that was challenging. And then I think it was there's just a lot of people in Beauty and the Beast all doing different things at once. So blocking the scene for Belle was like the hardest thing I've ever done blocking wise as a director, because it's 40 people on stage moving around like a marketplace, and I didn't want it just to be like the whole time. I didn't want people standing there the whole time, but it had to make sense. So that was a challenge. And then, as like any show, a director has to figure out the actors and figure out what analogies do I need to use to communicate what I want from this actor. How do I need to encourage this actor? Does this actor need more encouragement or more instruction? And so it was just figuring out each person and figuring out what do they need that will take them the next level to get where they need to be. I think every performance is different. Like maybe a little thing will go wrong, but then another thing will be so much better than you've ever even seen it. And as this is what's great about live theater, it's a different experience for everyone, because there's so many places to look on stage that I would watch someone different every time, you know? So the experience might be overall the same, but then I really enjoyed every single experience. Like, I enjoyed watching the show every night, because I would just focus on a different chorus member and be like, oh, they're doing that? That's hilarious. Or seeing another just another lead really get into their character. So, I think it was better than I expected, and when problems arose, I was pleasantly surprised by how seamlessly the actors carried on and the crew fixed things. So, I was very happy.
Hello?
What? Who is it?
Could you give a brief introduction about the process and how you made it?
Sure, yeah. So as far as how to make it, a lot of the priorities were to make sure that it was strong enough for students to walk on, of course. But we had the design of it was actually from Mr. Sachs. He and Miss Anderson designed the castle, and they chose kind of what they would like it to look like. And then me and Mr. Severin kind of sat down and tried to set up what would be the strongest way to make what they asked. So that was kind of the beginning process. And
what kind of factors do you need to consider about in order to make sure that nobody will fall down from the castle?
Oh yeah, that's okay, all right. Well, we built it kind of like you would build a house. The inside of a house is made with just a lot of pieces that are going upright. They just all go straight up in the air. And they're spaced about 16 inches apart. Those are called studs. So we just lined those up like many, many walls and just made sure that it would be strong enough. So.
The two of you are painting Val's room.
Well, it will soon be our room.
That's so sweet.
Hi, Mr. Carter.
Hi, how's it going?
Great.
Good. Just making a fire.
Yeah.
Picture this. A rustic hunting lodge.
Turn you down!
Or now? Well, a bell for my wife.
Look at us! Look at you!
What about me?
It's a girl!
She's the one!
Let her go!
No!
Let her go! Let her go!
Bell! Bell!
I know someone's there. Who are you?
First question is, could you tell us how the light on the stage works?
Generally, mm-hmm. It's about where is the action taking place on the stage? So where do I want the audience to look? So if I want the audience to be focused on Belle, I light up wherever she's at. Or if there's something happening somewhere else on stage that I want them to notice, like the rose, we always lit the rose because mm-hmm. we always want them to see that. So it's basically where do I want the audience to be looking.
How would you decide which color of the light to use for each scene?
Well, usually it's whatever color makes the most sense. So in the forest, I want it mostly green and dark. In the town, I want it mostly sunshiny and yellowy and bright. But one of the things that what I like to do was in the castle. in the beginning of the play, the castle is like kind of a dark and scary place.
Mm.
So I had a lot of like blues and purples, and it was really dark. But during the course of the show, the castle gets more happy and more bright and more hope. So if you, nobody notices this except for me, but in the beginning, the castle is dark blues and dark purples, but by the end of the show, it's a really bright blue, bright purple, and every scene that has the castle gets a little bit brighter each time. So it's kind of my subtle way of saying it's getting happier and more hope and it's getting better, so stuff like that.
What does it feel like to see the stage from the up corner of the audience?
It's kind of cool to see the stage from a different perspective than the audience. It's cool to be up above because you can kind of notice things that the audience doesn't see. And it's nice to not be surrounded by 150 people. But it is also a little tricky because to do lights, you need to know what the audience sees. So it's a little hard because from up above, it looks different than when you're below.
do you, Gaston?
I just played badminton with
Lefu,
and he beat me.
Oh, Lefu beat you! That was it! Your turn.
Describe the job as a stage manager.
Well, as a stage manager, I have a lot of different jobs. My job mostly is to keep everything organized, and that means keeping attendance for everyone, doing anything Miss Anderson needs, really, being the organizational side of the director, taking notes during all of the rehearsals, sending an email to everyone after every rehearsal to tell them announcements, and what we did and what we will do, keeping track of the schedule, keeping track of props and all of the movement on the stage, teaching scene changes and planning them out.
Transitions aren't fun.
Yeah.
They're a lot of work, but it's essential to making it pretty.
I think my favorite part of the show is actually during dress rehearsals and the performances when I get to be backstage. And yeah. It's always so fun because you never know what's going to happen backstage. And everyone who's watching the show doesn't know what goes on. And it's cool because I get to appreciate what happens on stage even more. You can appreciate a really good minute, a good moment in the show if you know all of these things had to happen in order to make that moment possible. And just getting to see the students backstage and the funny things that happen and just all of the hard work that goes on back there is probably my favorite part.
If we would like you to say one thing that you admire yourself for, what would that be?
Well, it's hard because everything in the show takes a lot of people to do. But I think the thing I was the most proud of this year, I also did the marketing and ticket sales for the musical, and the fact that we were able to sell out the entire show was really exciting. It wasn't just me, it was a lot of people involved in making that happen, but going into the show, my goal was to sell out one performance, and I didn't even know if we could do that, and then we sold out all of them, and there were people that still wanted to come to the show. That was really exciting to see the interest and the level of excitement that the school and the parents and other students had for this show was really cool.
How did you design the choreography for each dance, and how long did it take to finish creating this choreography?
So for each dance, I started working with Miss Anderson first. She would go through the whole song and give me the blocking for each section, and then from there I would know where people were, and then I would start kind of going through the music section by section and deciding kind of what I wanted for each section and breaking up the groups of people, so we knew like when the forks would come on, when the spoons would come on. And then from there, I took those little sections of music
took them down to the studio and created movement for each portion. Each section, the beginning took longer because by the time we started Human Again, we kind of had some motifs, like things that repeated throughout the show that I used again. But like Beauty and the Beast probably took, I don't know, 3 hours, 4 hours to plan at least, probably not including the time spent with Miss Anderson. So just on my own, like 3 or 4 hours. And then some of the shorter songs took less time. So like the mob song took a lot less time because a lot of that was Miss Anderson planning and then me kind of adding stuff at the last minute.
How is choreographing for musicals different from that for other common dances?
Really different. I haven't choreographed for a lot of musicals. I've done small numbers. I've never done like a full musical. I've mostly choreographed just dance. So the difference for me was like realizing that you guys had to have your faces facing out towards the audience because you were singing, realizing you had other things to kind of do rather than just the dance. And then for dance, I've taught large groups of people, but I've never choreographed for more than like 20 people probably, because you would never have. Very rarely would you have more than 20 people on stage in a dance. So like to have like 50 people to work with instead of 10. Is a huge change. It was really fun, it was a really cool experience, but kind of taking, and also because it was a musical, we had people of all different dance levels and kind of putting everyone together. Some people had a lot more dance experience, some people had no dance experience, so kind of working with that, putting everything together, and then being aware of the costumes and set and the fact that it was going in and out of other scenes rather than it just being really focused on the dance. It was more focused on other elements, so kind of working around all those elements was really interesting.
What does it feel like to be in a crew like this?
Great. I feel like I get to work with other dance teachers sometimes, but I rarely get to collaborate with a lot of other people, and especially not people who do other types of art. So getting to work with Ms. Korkos and Ms. Anderson was really, really cool. And to work with the students was amazing. I've kind of never really done musicals. I've worked with mostly just dance students before. So to get to work with such a large group of really talented people doing a lot of different things was really, really cool. And I think the students created such a positive atmosphere that it was a really fun thing to be a part of.
Yes!
First of all, how did you decide to do this musical?
Oh my gosh. Well, Beauty and the Beast has always been like, I mean, it's a classic musical. It's a favorite, you know, loved by adults and children, and for many, many years, people have known the story. So, you know, I think Miss Anderson and I, we kind of thought about what musicals we liked and what we thought people in China would also like. And, you know, that just kept coming back to, like, the top of our list.
And as you are the music director, like, are there any challenges in the music?
Definitely, definitely. the music is so much harder than Fiddler on the Roof. And, you know, everything about it is also so much more exciting. So you're dealing with not only the element of, like, okay, the music is more challenging, there's a lot more, like, difficult words to say and
French.
Different harmonies, and you're learning French words inside of there. There's all of that, and then you're also dealing with the aspect of, like, when you're on stage, it's so much brighter and livelier, and every single person on stage has to do that, you know? So as a director, trying to pull that out of your students is, you know, really difficult. And to be honest, like, after our first music rehearsal, when we rehearsed Belle, I was really scared. like, I thought, oh my gosh, I don't know how we're gonna learn all these songs. But, you know, like, everyone, and the cast worked so hard. You know, I would teach part threes their part, and they would, like, remember it the next time. And, you know, it just took a lot of teaching and then polishing, teaching and polishing. But everyone did a great job.
What is the differences between like singing in a musical chorus and singing in a choir?
I think musical theater is different because you're thinking about so many things at the same time. You know, with musical theater, you need to learn the music and then you need to forget about it. You know what I mean? What I'm saying is you learn it so well that you don't have to think about what comes next because you're thinking about where do you go on stage next and what's your next choreography. And you're also thinking about being involved in the scene on stage, you know, trying to react with your body and your face. So with musical theater, I think it's so important that you know your music almost 10 times better than you do in a regular choir because you've got so many other things to think about.
What is your like the most unforgettable memory or the something that you remember really clearly have a great impression?
Oh my gosh. Honestly, I can't think of like one moment, but I'll like one rehearsal that I remember was probably really hard for the kids. It was just me and Miss Jenkins. We were up there and we were going over and over and over like Human Again and Beauty and Be Our Guest. And like I know it's not fun, you know, for the cast to go over and over and over again, but like those are the rehearsals where I feel like we really, that's the hard work. Do you know what I mean? Because a musical, it's fun and we felt like a family, you know, our cast and everything, but there are those moments where it's purely work, you know? So honestly, like in my memory, that day is really, really clear.
I don't usually leave the asylum in the middle of the night, but this fellas, and you make it worth my while. Look, I've got my heart set on marrying Mel, but she needs a little persuasion.
Turning down a flat.
I planned who would have what microphone mm-hmm. and who needed to share, and it was like a big puzzle that you helped
yes.
me solve at one point. but so I was in charge of that and deciding which parts needed microphones. Miss Corcos mm-hmm. and Miss Anderson and I had a meeting and we're like, oh, Cookie can sing really loudly, so we don't have a microphone. She can be without one for a little bit, but then she has to have one for this scene because her line's really important. Mm-hmm. So it was a lot of discussions like that.
So like during the show, you have mm-hmm. that microphone on, like talking to
yeah.
the crews.
Yeah.
Like Miss Barkas, could you help me check someone's microphone?
Those poor people listen to my voice in their ear for nights and nights on end, and mm-hmm. I'd be yelling, "Belle's mic isn't on! Belle's mic isn't on! Barkas! Go get Belle's mic, what's wrong?" Or saying things less panicked like, "The Beast's mic is off of his face again, someone needs to fix that when he comes off stage." so that was my job. There's one time the silly girls, something was happening and we knew something was hitting the mic and mm-hmm. I think it was Nico's curls got caught around the mic. Or your curls, someone's curls, it wasn't Annie's, hers aren't long enough. But someone's curls were caught around the microphone and it would hit it and it would make a weird sound. And so it took us a while to be like, who is it? Like, and we're just mm-hmm. sitting up there. The three of us are just like, it's Cookie. Because we were like able to see like
the curls
hitting the microphone. And so afterwards I'm like, check Cookie's mic. And she's like, okay. So she just like makes sure curls
yeah,
are gone and
when
like.
When I went back to the action, it was like, stop, I'll check the microphone.
And I was calling cues for the microphones and the spotlights and the lights. So there's a lot more than three.
I want to like, want you to show the cue part a little
okay.
bit.
Okay, ready?
Yeah.
Okay. Barkas, prepare the mic backstage. Standby mics 3, 4, and 14. Standby mute group 5. Standby lights 18. Standby art spot 21. Mics 3, 4, 14, go. Lights 18, go dark. Mute, group 5, go. Standby, mute, mic 12.
Meanwhile, back in the dark alley of the village, Gascon held a secret meeting.
Mute, mic 12. Standby, lights 19. Standby, Andy, spot 22. individual clear mutes. 1, 2, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 13, 15, 16. Clear mute group 5. Standby mics 2, 6, 7. Mics 2, 6, 7, go. Lights 19, go. Oh, that's so complicated.
People never notice when technology is good. Like,
yes,
that's the point of technology, is to make it so it's not noticeable. But everyone notices when it goes wrong. It's like, I can't hear Belle. Do you think they know you can't hear Belle? It's like, yes. So.
But, like, we did pretty good fixing.
Yes, yes. The crew, the cast was wonderful at covering for all of the little things.
Skirt and do some extra works on them, or you made it completely by yourself?
Some of them I made completely by myself. Some of them I bought pieces and then I made it really what I needed.
Like some special customs, like Madame's custom, you made it completely by yourself?
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah. Oh, Madame. Mrs. Potts, Lumiere, Cogsworth, Babette. In fact, Babette is the first one I made.
Really? That's a cool skirt.
Yeah.
Here goes Belle and Gaston cooperating, making costumes for the servants. Gaston, what are you doing?
I'm flirting with Belle.
What?
No. That's not what he's doing.
Publicly humiliating. Again.
Show me the beast.
That's him. That's him.
Like really slow motion.
Good luck! Then there's like